Welcome to everyone who's filing in. We'll get started right at noon. And if you are here already, kudos for being first. Go ahead and drop in the chat where you're tuning in from and we can see where everyone is located. And I'll go ahead and pull up my presentation. Alicia, can you give me them on the right screen?
Yes.
Awesome. And for folks who are just rolling in, go ahead and drop in the chat if you'd like where you're tuning in from. I see we've got some people from East Coast, some Iowans, Minnesota, a nice little spread. Well, I think I'm seeing that it's noon or whatever time zone you're in. It's time to get started. So I'll go ahead and kick us off just so that we can stay good on time. Welcome everyone to our latest clean water webinar where we'll be talking about Nitrate Watch and the fight against nutrient pollution. I'm Heather Wilson. I'm the Isaac Walton League's Midwest Save Our Streams coordinator. And I'm joined today by Alicia Vasto. Do you wanna say hi, Alicia?
Yep. Hi, everyone. Alicia Vasto. I'm the Water Program Director with the Iowa Environmental Council.
And like I said, today we'll be giving an introduction to the Nitrate Watch program, and I'll be handing it over to Alicia for the latter sort of half of the program to talk about the Iowa Environmental Council's work against nutrient pollution. Before we really dive in, though, I do want to just do some housekeeping stuff. We are recording today, so that means if you need to hop off early or if you just want to go back and revisit anything, we'll be sharing that recording after the fact. And then you might have already discovered there's a chat and a Q&A function. If you have questions throughout the presentations today, go ahead and drop those in the Q&A. That'll be like our one-stop shop to view everyone's questions, and we'll most likely take those at the end. Sam is on in the background kind of monitoring those, so if she sees something that we should answer right away, she will hop on and interrupt us. But otherwise, we'll take those at the end. So with that, I'm actually going to drop off video just so that internet is not struggling. There we go. And I'll dive in. Maybe. There we go. So like I said, we're going to talk about Nitrate Watch today. And we wanted to give a formal sort of introduction to this program because it is quite new. And I know there's probably some of you out there who may not be familiar with it at all. So Nitrate Watch is the Isaac Walton League's latest community science program. And as you might guess, it focuses on nitrate pollution. It launched in February of this year. And I'll give a brief overview of sort of what it is and how you can get involved if you're not already. But first, I want to give just a real brief overview of the issue, nitrate pollution. So if you're not familiar with nitrate pollution, nitrate is a naturally occurring compound, consists of nitrogen and oxygen molecules. It's found in plants, it's found in organic waste. Some plants have the ability to grab nitrogen gas out of the air and fix it via their roots. And it is a nutrient. It's necessary for plant growth. It's found in enzymes and proteins and chlorophyll molecules. And we actually apply it to the landscape for that purpose. Unfortunately, the rate at which nitrate is applied to the landscape is just so much so that soils and plants aren't able to take up all the nitrate that's applied. And unfortunately, nitrate is very soluble in water, which means it dissolves really easily and it's carried off via surface water runoff, groundwater infiltration, ultimately ending up in waterways. So where is all this nitrate coming from? Well, it's coming from fertilizers, both in an agricultural context and also urban or, you know, residential. Animal feedlots produce a lot of manure. We also see nitrate coming out of wastewater treatment facilities and sort of arriving via atmospheric deposition, which is when nitrogen-rich gases interface with water and actually transform into nitrate. I do want to point out, we obviously know that agriculture contributes a lot of nitrate, in fact, the majority of nitrate to our drinking and surface waters. But I do want to just make it clear that there are urban sources, and all urban centers, for the most part, are downstream of other areas, many of which are agricultural, rural. So this is a problem that affects everyone and that has a diverse array of sources. So what's the problem, right? Why do we care about nitrate pollution? I'm going to go over the impacts of nitrate pollution on these three sort of areas of life. So first, environment. The environmental impact of it adding a bunch of excess nutrients to a system is really complex, but it's been studied pretty intensely. And we know that adding nitrate or other nutrient pollution to a natural system sets off this cascade of effects. So first off, adding a bunch of nutrients to fresh water causes the plants that are there to really bloom and boom and thrive. Predominantly algae, because algae is very opportunistic and fast growing. So when algae blooms in a water body, it does a lot of sort of not so good things. It blocks out light lower in the water column. It throws off the pH. And also ultimately that algae will die. And when that happens, it decomposes in the water, and the process of decomposition reduces the amount of oxygen that is present in the water. It kind of eats it up. And so what this leads to is areas that have lower dissolved oxygen, which if you're one of the fish or the macroinvertebrates living in the freshwater system, it's more difficult to survive. And so we see dead zones, which are areas that are hypoxic or low in oxygen. And we also see events like fish kills. So all this is pretty detrimental, obviously, to the natural system. Unfortunately, it's also detrimental to human health in some cases. So in surface waters with those algae blooms, sometimes we see algae blooms harboring cyanobacteria, which can create cyanotoxins. If you've heard of microcystin, that's probably the most well-known one. Red tides and coastal ecosystems are a result of this. And those toxins, depending on what they are, can be really dangerous to humans and pets. And wildlife, if ingested or even if just inhaled. So obviously that's not great. But another really important human health effect is if nitrate does end up in large concentrations in drinking water sources, and if it's consumed in, you know, prolonged or even sometimes just a few doses, it can have different effects on human health. So the first is the most well-known is blue baby syndrome or MET hemoglobinemia. This is a syndrome that affects infants 6 months or younger. And it basically just makes it really hard for their bodies to move oxygen around. The nitrate affects how our body transports oxygen, and it can be really serious and even deadly. More recent research has connected nitrate consumption to thyroid disease, different neural tube birth defects like spina bifida and anencephaly, and several cancers, but especially colon cancer. Now there is a drinking water standard. So that means that the EPA has placed a maximum contaminant level, basically saying there cannot be a level of nitrate exceeding 10 parts per million or 10 milligrams per liter in public drinking water sources. This was created in 1992, and it was specifically to prevent blue baby syndrome, which was pretty well understood at the time, and they found that 10 parts per million was enough to increase risk of that. But unfortunately, those other sources we talked about, thyroid disease, cancers, birth defects, are also linked with lower concentrations of nitrate in drinking water if it's being consumed in a prolonged exposure. So that means that there's a potential that this drinking water standard might not be protective of human health at its current level. And of course, we're only talking about public drinking water utilities. Unfortunately, there's no regulation on the water that's distributed by private wells. And so the only way to know if your water contains nitrate if you're on a private well is to do consistent testing. It doesn't have an appearance or an odor or a detectable taste. So next, of course, there's an economic impact to everything we've just talked about. Removing nitrate from drinking water is not cheap. Unfortunately, traditional conventional drinking water treatment doesn't address nitrate pollution. You need special infrastructure to remove nitrates, and it is quite expensive. Obviously, the medical costs associated with those diseases we talked about, and also the lost productivity for people affected by those diseases really adds up. As you can imagine, this affects different industries that rely on clean and healthy waterways, like the fishing industry. When fish and shellfish are contaminated by harmful algae blooms or cyanobacteria, it makes them unusable. And recreation, obviously, we don't want to be paddling or recreating near waterways that are dangerous or just unsightly. And then the same is true of property values that are on waterfront property. They really suffer when the water itself is no longer safe or fun to be around. So all of this adds up to an estimated $210 billion economic impact just in the United States per year. So if I haven't convinced you enough, this should be another argument for why this is a really big deal and something that we hope to address with our new program, Nitrate Watch. So this program is based off of our successful Salt Watch program, which has been around for several years now, and it is mobilizing volunteers to monitor nitrate in their surface waters, so rivers, lakes, streams, and also drinking water. We can sample public and private water systems with this program. As you might imagine, this is a really large, diffuse issue with a lot of really big systemic causes and inputs. And so we're really excited to create this way for people to do something hands-on, tangible, to make a difference in the fight against nitrate pollution. Filling in data gaps, educating others, all this stuff is super important, and it's something that each of us can actually play an active role in. So what are the goals of this program? First and foremost, we want to raise awareness about the impacts of nitrate on the environment and human health. When we are talking about this all the time, it seems kind of innate that obviously we would want to prevent nitrate pollution because it is bad for the environment, it's bad for human health. But these are things that we can't assume that anyone is aware of. I'll admit that when I first started studying this issue, I wasn't aware of the extent of the human health impacts. And so for someone like me who lives and breathes this stuff to not be aware, imagine how many people walking around in our communities don't know, right? Obviously, we want to identify areas that have high nitrate pollution. So that's where we're going to need your help in collecting data so that we can spot those hotspots. And of course, the goal is not just data, but also action. So our third pillar here is advocacy for solutions that will reduce nitrate pollution. And this is a photo of everything that comes in a Nitrate Watch kit. These kits are free while supplies last. So in every kit, we include nitrate test strips. You get a whole bottle, which has 25 strips. We also include postcards, which explain how to use the test strips and also how to submit your data to our National Water Quality Database, and also a sticker so that you can show us off and put us on your water bottle or your laptop or wherever. So real quick, all this information is on the postcards that come in the kit. So don't feel like you have to take notes or anything, but I just want to demonstrate how truly easy it is to participate. So if you haven't already and you want to participate in Nitrate Watch, you can head to our website, nitratewatch.org, and you'll just fill out the pledge, which is saying, yes, I'm going to use all my test strips and I'm going to report back my data and I'm going to tell everyone I know. I'm paraphrasing, obviously, but you'll fill out that pledge and request a kit, and we'll drop it in the mail. And then once your kit is in your hands, you'll head out to a waterway that you care about, or even to your kitchen sink if you're measuring a public or private water source, and you'll measure nitrate. So the test is super simple and the instructions are included in the kit, but it only takes 30 seconds to take a reading, so not a huge time commitment. And you're basically just comparing the color of that top pad to the color on the side of the bottle, and really could not be simpler. And last but not least, we want to know what your data is. So we have a really easy way for you to report your results on the Clean Water Hub, which is our national water quality database. And we've created a little kind of side door with this short link, cleanwaterhub.org/nitratewatch. If you already have an account on the hub, like if you participate in Save Our Streams, you don't have to create a new account or anything. It'll all be linked with your existing account. It's super easy to make an account if you don't already have one. And obviously it is free. So there you go. That's it. After data has been added, you can view it on a couple different places. This is our nice color-coded interactive map. You can see we've already got quite a bit of data coming in. A lot of this is baseline readings. So we'll see peaks later in sort of the summer. But if you zoom in on some of these areas with a lot of dots, you'll see there are actually some high readings already coming in. There's one kind of peeking out in Detroit, but there's others. So really interesting. You could definitely spend some time just exploring the map. And if you click on any one of these sites, you'll be taken to a page that includes all of its data. And so this one is from a spot in Story County. They've been monitoring for years really consistently, but as you add more data to your sites, you'll get a similar picture with a graph that shows you the change over time. It's also color coded to show sort of the severity of your readings. And this can be a really powerful tool to not only visualize your results for yourself, but also to share with other people who might be affected or have some education to do about nitrate in your community. Speaking of education, we have a lot of resources out there to help you both learn more about nitrate pollution yourself and share that education with other folks who might need to know. So first here, these are all on our Nitrate Watch website, nitratewatch.org. But we've got the Make a Plan worksheet. If you're just getting started with Nitrate Watch and you want to kind of think through the logistics of how to use up those 25 test strips in a really effective way, we've got questions here that will help you do that. Like, where do you want to monitor? And how often do you want to monitor? And also, who are you going to talk to if you find some troubling results? Our FAQs page is also a great place to find lots of answers to commonly asked questions about nitrate pollution, the sources, the impacts, but also how to participate in Nitrate Watch. If you have questions about like how to submit results, that's a good first place to go. But obviously we are happy to answer your questions in an email too. And then blogs. We have a few blogs already created and we'll be adding more over time, but these are great resources to kind of dive into some of the key issues related to nitrate pollution. And back to advocacy. As you know, we really care about making a difference, not just collecting data, but doing something with that data. So to try and help you do something with your Nitrate Watch data, we've got some advocacy resources already created. The first is a petition that's sort of just calling for elected officials and community leaders to address this issue. We've got letters to the editor and letters to representatives. These are templates that you can take and make your own. And send them off to whom they may concern. And then we've created several fact sheets. These are really good educational resources and good for handing out if you happen to be interacting with folks in your community who you think need to learn more about nitrate pollution. So this is a little snapshot of some of those fact sheets. We've got one on the economic impact, talking about some of those different sort of areas that are impacted by nitrate pollution. We've got nitrates in drinking water, which is all about the human health side. This clean soil, clean water fact sheet is about some of the best management practices that can help reduce nitrate runoff. And then there's one about nitrates and algae, kind of like the environmental side. So really excited to share some of our stats. I actually updated this morning. So these are really current. We have since just a couple months ago, February 1st, we fulfilled 279 kit requests, sending those out to participants in 30 states plus DC. So really exciting and super grateful to you guys who have requested kits so far. And I do want to just quickly mention our sponsors and say thank you. These are motivated and passionate individuals who have donated to help support this program. We actually did hit a time, I think it was late February, where we ran out of kits. And so we had to start a wait list. And thanks to the donations of those sponsors, we were able to open it back up to everyone and fulfill the requests on our wait list. These kits are free to request, but they're not free to us to provide. So we are actually approaching the next waitlist period, I believe. We're going to probably hit our maximum again. So if you're listening and you're interested in supporting this program, helping us reach people without any financial barriers, definitely consider visiting iwla.org/nitrate sponsor. We really appreciate our sponsors. And this is a fun map of where all of our kits have gone so far. And if you're looking at this and you're seeing your state or your area is not covered in a little orange pin, you should help us fix that and request a kit, because we would love to say that we've got kits in every state. If your area is covered in a pin, you are still welcome to request a kit. I'm not saying that you shouldn't, but definitely share with folks in your area who should be testing as well. And this slide is really fun. On the Nitrate Watch pledge, we ask, you know, beyond monitoring, how do you plan to make a difference about nitrate pollution? And you don't have to respond, but a lot of people do. And they say some really great stuff about sort of going the extra mile and making a difference, hosting cleanup events, educating neighbors or students or homeowners associations, or talking with their public and state officials, writing the letter to the editor. There's so many great ways to go the extra mile, and we're just so heartened and so excited to see what some people have already said, and we cannot wait to see this stuff in real life. So as you're hosting those cleanup events and spreading the word, definitely keep us in the loop so that we can congratulate you and pat you on the back. So that was my quick whirlwind. I don't want to take too much time because I want Alicia to have plenty of time to talk as well. But I do just want to leave you with my email address. This is a great place if you have questions about participating, about submitting results or anything at all. Shoot us an email at nitratewatch@iwla.org. And of course, you can visit our website to request a kit, find those education and advocacy resources, and more. So with that, I am going to stop sharing my screen and I can kick it on over to Alicia. Unless, Sam, do we have any questions we need to answer now?
I think we can save them to the end.
Sweet. Great. All right.
All right. Well, thank you, Heather, and thank you all for having me to talk a little bit about the Iowa Environmental Council and our work on nitrate pollution here in Iowa. I'm going to share my screen. Okay. So, just briefly, I want to share with you a little bit about the Iowa Environmental Council and who I am. I'm Alicia Vasto, the Water Program Director for the Council. I've been with the Council for about 4 years, just a little over 4 years now. So if you want to get a hold of me, there's my email address. I am from Iowa originally. I was born here just west of Des Moines, and now I currently live in Des Moines. So yeah, I'm going to share a little bit more about the Iowa Environmental Council. I'm going to talk about our water quality crisis, specifically here in Iowa, just to give you a little bit of background. I'm going to talk about law and policy solutions, recommendations that we have, and then what you can do, especially if you're here in Iowa with us. So IEC is a nonprofit organization. We work on law and policy issues related to water, land, climate, and energy here in Iowa. Our mission is a just, healthy environment and a sustainable future for all Iowans. So we do this work through a variety of different approaches, but primarily through policy work. We work at the state level policy and also have gotten involved in some federal level and local level policy as well. We are a coalition organization made up of over 100 member orgs, including the Isaac Walton League. So we work a lot on coalition building and working with partners from other nonprofits and businesses that care about these issues as well. And when policy is an outreach are of no avail to us, we will take action through rulemaking in the courts when necessary. So we really try to follow the science and try to come up with the best solutions to protect Iowa, protect Iowa's future, and protect our environment. So just a little bit of background on Iowa's water quality crisis. I noticed some of you are from Iowa, but many of you are not. So just to share a little bit with you about the lay of the land here and the issues that we face. I think, you know, they're common to many states, especially in the Midwest. But, you know, here in Iowa, things are really quite extreme because of the level of agricultural production that we have. So sometimes we are referred to as the most altered landscape in the world. You know, we used to have a lot of prairie and woodlands here in Iowa, and then most of that has been converted into row crop acres and pasture land. So of Iowa's 35 million acres, about 24 to 26 million are in row crop production. And that's just primarily corn and soybeans. And we are really low on the amount of public land that we have. I think we rank 47th or 48th out of all the states for public land. So 97% of the land here in Iowa is privately owned. So anytime that we talk about conservation, we're primarily talking about agricultural land conservation and private lands conservation. So we really have an industrialized system of agriculture here. And these photos represent some really extreme examples, but kind of emblematic of what we see here and what we face. So a lot of bare soils throughout most of the year when there is no crop production, a lot of tile drainage, which is made to reduce the amount of water that is on the fields and discharge it very quickly into nearby rivers and streams. And then we don't really have any regulation around agriculture. So we often have farming right up to the edges of streams. And we have a lot of stream degradation, you know, eroding banks and things like that. So people could be even farming into the stream if they wanted to. We also have a lot of concentrated animal feeding operations. We have seven times as many hogs as we do people here in Iowa. We've really become a safe haven for CAFOs and this livestock production. And that has a really huge impact on our landscape because these animals produce a lot of manure. And manure is really high in nitrogen and phosphorus. And so it often gets applied as fertilizer to the land. So in addition to commercial fertilizers that are used for crop production, we also have manure that is being used and being spread across the land. And so unlike, you know, human waste that is treated before it's discharged into a nearby stream or river, this waste is applied to the land without any treatment. And anything that is in excess of plant needs will be carried away into our rivers and streams. So this is a huge source of the water quality issues that we have here. And the regulations around these feeding operations are very lax. They're nearly automatically approved here. The state legislature has taken away local input and control of the siting of these operations. And there's just really no protections for sensitive landscapes and drinking water sources. So these are things that I'll talk a little bit more about later and how we're trying to address this. But we have, I think, over 12,000 CAFOs in our state now, which is much more than any other state in the nation. And so what does this mean for our water quality? Well, we obviously have nutrient pollution, that's nitrogen and phosphorus. We have bacteria pollution from animal manure, E. coli and other pathogens. And then we have a lot of sediment in our waterways. And, you know, the pollution mitigation for agriculture is voluntary. There are very few requirements on agricultural production. There are some requirements related to CAFOs. But as far as row cropping, you know, there may be some compliance measures if you're getting funding from the federal government that you need to try to protect your lands from erosion, but there's really no regulations around how you're farming your land. And then, of course, we know that climate change is exacerbating a lot of the outcomes related to our water issues, and I'll talk a little bit more about that as well. And one of the big things that we talk about here in Iowa is kind of the inequality of this. So we have a lot of pollution that is coming from upstream, and you know, a lot of the costs of pollution are externalized. So people downstream are paying for the removal of nitrate from their drinking water, or they're paying for this pollution as a result of long-term healthcare costs and things like that. So there's really an imbalance in the responsibility for the pollution. And, you know, Heather talked about this quite a bit, so I don't need to go into specifics, but, you know, here in Des Moines, especially, we had a nitrate removal facility built at Des Moines Water Works, which is our public water system here. That was built in 1992. That's how long we've known about the nitrate issue in our drinking water. And at the time that it was built, it was the largest removal facility in the world. And when Des Moines Water Works has to run that nitrate removal facility, those costs get passed on to customers. And Des Moines Water Works serves about 600,000 people here in central Iowa, which is about a sixth of the state's population. So there are a lot of people. It's not just an urban issue. There are a lot of folks in more rural areas around here that also rely on that drinking water. And then, of course, there are other public utilities that have nitrate issues and are having to make upgrades and do treatment for nitrate removal. And then about 10% of Iowans are on private wells. And as Heather mentioned, private wells are not regulated at all. It's up to the owner of the private well to do the testing and to do the treatment of their well to know what's going on and to make sure that their water is not contaminated. So this was this map is from an analysis that the Environmental Working Group did a couple of years ago. And, you know, they found that I think it was more than 40% of the wells that were tested were contaminated with E. coli bacteria or nitrate or both. And the vast majority of those wells had really only been tested once in the 20-year period. So there's really low data on private wells and people just getting their wells tested and actually figuring out what they can do to treat their private wells. And then of course we deal with harmful algae blooms as well. You know, we're not typically known for our beaches here in Iowa, but we do have quite a few lakes. And, you know, being very low in public lands, lakes are often the centerpieces of our state parks or our local parks. And people do go there to swim and enjoy and fish and everything. And so in the summer, we're seeing a lot of harmful algae blooms that can prevent people from entering the waterways. And, you know, that takes away some of those recreational dollars that would otherwise be spent, especially in rural economies where those can be really big draws. And then we know that climate change is exacerbating the occurrence of harmful algae blooms. So we know that there are links between increased heat and increased carbon dioxide and an increased instance of harmful algae blooms. And we've seen our climate drier and hotter in the last few years, especially. We've had some severe drought. And so we have seen more algae blooms occurring, and there's a lot of potential for that. And algae blooms also really threaten drinking water. So the microcystin that can be produced by the bacteria there's really no safe limit for it in drinking water. And so there was a situation in Toledo in 2014 where Lake Erie, where they get their water, had a harmful algae bloom, and there was microcystin in their finished drinking water. And they had to go on a bottled water advisory for several days. That's a situation that we've gotten close to here in Des Moines as well. There, Sailorville Lake is a reservoir that's just north of here that is on the Des Moines River, and it often has harmful algae blooms. And when there is microcystin in that water, the Des Moines Water Works has to either stop using that as a water source entirely, or kind of blend the water to make sure that it's in low enough concentrations that it's not going to affect people's health. And so, you know, this is something that could be a really serious, that is a really serious issue for us. But, you know, could, we just are concerned that it could get to the point that our water is undrinkable here. And that would be for, you know, 600,000 people. So we really see an imbalance of the public rights and individual rights here. So agricultural production as a private right really gets a lot of it's placed at a higher priority than a lot of the public rights that we have to our waterways. And so we have a lot of regular folks, taxpayers, downstream neighbors that are paying the costs for agricultural pollution. And that's something that we really want to see addressed in a way that's fair and equitable and makes sense for everyone. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Iowa's nutrient reduction strategy. The nutrient reduction strategy is, oh my gosh, I'm sorry, there's sirens outside, it's scary. The nutrient reduction strategy is Iowa's main policy for addressing nutrient pollution. So this is actually prompted by the Gulf Hypoxia Task Force, which is a federal task force made up of 12 different states that feed into the Mississippi River and the Gulf of Mexico. And the task force was formed in 1998. The dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico was identified as early as the 1960s or 70s. And so when the task force was created, they called on states to create their own nutrient reduction strategies. And so Iowa wrote theirs and adopted it in 2013. And then it was formally adopted in state code in 2018 by the state legislature. So what is this nutrient reduction strategy? So it primarily focuses on non-point source pollution, which would be primarily agriculture. We know that 92% of the nitrogen in our waterways comes from non-point sources like agriculture. 80% of the phosphorus comes from non-point sources like agriculture. So that's the main portion of the strategy. And it basically lays out a series of recommendations for different conservation practices that should be adopted on agricultural lands to help reduce the loss of nutrients from cropland. We've found that the strategy is really flawed. It doesn't have a lot of the things that a typical strategy would have, like a timeline or benchmarks for assessing progress, and nothing about like specifically where what practices should go where and on what kind of a time frame. Instead, they have a series of scenarios, which we hear about less and less in recent years. But at the time that it was written, there were three scenarios that were proposed to say, okay, if we were to actually get to the reductions that we need in nutrients in our waterways, what would it take in terms of conservation practices on the land? What does it look like? So this is scenario one, as it was called. And the scientific assessment committee found that in order to reach the 45% reduction, we would need 12.6 million acres of cover crops here in Iowa. So that's about half of the row cropped acreage that we have here would need to be in cover crops in the winter. We would need 7.7 million acres of those row crops treated by wetlands. We would need 6 million acres treated by bioreactors or saturated buffers. And then we would need a nitrogen application rate that matched plant needs on all acres. So no over application of nitrogen fertilizer. And that would be what it would take to see us reaching that goal of 45% reduction. So IUC did this analysis a couple years ago with the most recent data that's available to us. So basically at the rate of adoption of these different practices, how long would it take to get there to these results that are needed? And so looking at the cover crop goal to get to 12.6 million acres of cover crops in Iowa, it would take more than 80 years for us to get half of Iowa's row crop acres and cover crops. And so row crop or cover crops are actually one of the more popular conservation practices that's being adopted at a faster rate. When we look at these other practices, it's really grim. So for wetlands, it would take more than 900 years to get 7.7 million acres treated by wetlands. And for bioreactors and saturated buffers, it would take more than 22,000 years at the current rate of adoption. So, you know, there at the time that, you know, we did this analysis with the data available, there were only 2,000 acres that were being treated by these practices. And, you know, we would need 6 million acres treated by them. So that's just an absolute drop in the bucket of what is necessary. So this is kind of all of that data taken together. So just to put really into perspective the scale of the problem that we have and the scale of the solutions that are necessary, if we do not have volunteers to do these practices, we're never going to get there, or we're, you know, at the best case, going to get there in maybe 22,000 years. And in fact, the nitrate load leaving our state is actually increasing. This was an analysis from a few years ago where they measured how much nitrogen was leaving the state. And since 2003, this red line is the total for the watershed. It has doubled. It has actually doubled and increased. And the strategy was adopted in 2013. So we're heading in the wrong direction on this. And then at the same time, we do have requirements for point sources of this pollution. So our drinking water treatment plants, our wastewater treatment plants, they are required to meet certain permits for discharges, and they are required to meet drinking water standards. And so our point sources are having to pay for a lot of upgrades. They're facing a lot of difficulty providing safe drinking water for citizens, and those costs are being passed on to Iowans. So we just really see this imbalance in, you know, what is the major source of the nutrients that we have and what is actually being enforced and required. They do not match up. So from our perspective, and I think kind of objectively, the voluntary measures are not working. So agriculture has been excused from assuming the offsite costs of doing business. And we believe that policy needs to support regenerative agriculture and limiting the pollution that we're seeing in our waterways. and you know, hold that in equal value to agricultural production, the public's rights and the agricultural production rights. So that's kind of the basis and background for how we approach looking at law and policy solutions. And so I'm going to move into that section now, and I'll try to go a little bit quicker since I know we have some questions and things we want to get to, but just some of the things that I wanted to talk about are, you know, our recommendations for improving the nutrient reduction strategy, improvements that we'd like to see in water quality monitoring, basic standards of care that we'd like to see universally adopted in our state, strengthened water quality standards and CAFO regulations. So for the nutrient reduction strategy, this year is the 10-year anniversary of the adoption of the strategy. And we came out with this publication last year where we had some recommendations about what we'd like to see, you know, in a 10-year review of the strategy. Here are some things that we need to do to actually turn it into a real strategy. The science behind the strategy is really good, but the policy pieces about how we're enacting it are what is weak and what is failing us. So we really need to adopt some timelines. We need to identify consequences, or what are we going to change for failing to meet our targets? We think we need to conduct this 10-year review and identify practices that should be universally adopted. And we'd also like to see some targeted watershed projects done with some targeted monitoring to see what is actually being effective. And then we'd also like to see numeric nutrient criteria adopted, which I'll talk about in a moment as well. We also have specific suggestions around monitoring. So we think that the approach to water quality monitoring around the nutrient reduction strategy is really lacking. So this is another report that we came out with last year that had specific recommendations for improving our monitoring strategy at the state level. These are some universal or some basic standards of care that we believe should be adopted universally. So universal riparian buffers, not being able to farm right up to the edge of the stream, being required to leave some space there. That's a basic one. And that is not out of the realm of possibility. There are other states that have buffer requirements like Minnesota and Wisconsin. And so we believe that this is something that Iowa should adopt as well. We think there should be limits to fall fertilizer application. So when fertilizer is applied in the fall, it is often gone off the field before the plants can even access it when they're planted in the spring. So there are states that have adopted these limitations already as well, Maryland, Nebraska, and Wisconsin. So that's another one that is kind of a basic standard. And then also watershed management action plans. So Florida has actually done this, where in watersheds where the water is impaired, each farm has to come up with a management plan for their farm about the specific conservation practices that they are going to do to help protect and improve that waterway. And so it's specific to that site. You know, we often hear there's no one size fits all. Well, let's come up with some plans that are specific to the operations that are actually going to help make improvements. We think that that is very doable, and Florida is already doing it and seeing positive results. We also think we need to strengthen our water quality standards. So this is what I meant when I said numeric nutrient criteria. So currently, our water quality standards for nutrients are narrative instead of numeric. So it's more descriptive and open to interpretation than just a strict number. And so we have asked the state to adopt numeric standards for nitrogen and phosphorus in our waterways. Other states on this map that you can see have adopted nitrogen and phosphorus criteria at some level. And we've petitioned the state multiple times to adopt them. And while the standards themselves are not going to clean up the waterways, they will set a really bright line in terms of what is acceptable for pollution for this waterway and what is not. And then the state will be required to come up with a cleanup plan for the states that are not meeting the standards. So like I said, we've petitioned for this and the state has rejected it, more to come, and hopefully we'll see some standards adopted here in the next few years. We've also petitioned the state to strengthen rules related to concentrated animal feeding operations. So just briefly, you know, we have asked them to protect sensitive landscapes from the development of these animal feeding operations. And we've also asked them to adopt a floodplain map because confinements are not supposed to be built in the 100-year floodplain, but we have seen them being built in the 100-year floodplain. So we've petitioned the state and they are currently revising their rules related to siting and manure storage. So we've been working with DNR on trying to get those rules in the best shape that we can, even with industry pressure. So hopefully we will see some changes to that this year as well. So what is the result of policy that supports regenerative ag and properly regulates production agriculture? So we believe that this will restore the balance of interest for Iowans. It will restore the balance of interest between agriculture and the public, even the playing field for farmers, provide some equity and environmental justice in terms of who the pollution is affecting, and will help us allocate our limited resources in really strategic ways. We also think that regulation is an opportunity that economies will form up around these regulations. More businesses will come in to help reach compliance. We've seen that in many other industries that are regulated in this way. And we think Iowa could be a real leader if we took that opportunity. So I'll breeze through these last slides. You know, if you're involved in Nitrate Watch, that is awesome. We encourage folks to get involved with groups like the Isaac Walton League and our other members. We also send out action alerts and hold events. And we do a lot of advocacy related to the Iowa State Legislature. If you're in Iowa and interested, please sign up for our emails. We'll share more information with you. And we also have our Iowa Water Watch program, where we share information, especially in the summer, about water quality. And we're hoping to incorporate some of the Nitrate Watch data into this newsletter and programming that we have. And if anyone is in Des Moines, please join us tomorrow at Peace Tree for a beverage. We'll be there in the afternoon, and I'm happy to talk further with you all about water quality. And so that is all that I have. So I will stop sharing, and I think we have questions.
Thank you, Alicia. We're really grateful for the work that Iowa Environmental Council does. Sam, were you going to chime in with some questions?
Yes, the first one I have on my list is, have you considered coordinating with Trout Unlimited on their WISE H2O application, sharing and compiling data and efforts for a more significant result?
You know, I'll admit I'm actually not super familiar with that app, but we are definitely in a phase where we're looking for partners and sort of, you know, willing organizations to either share data or, you know, get more people on the ground monitoring. So definitely, if you want to email nitratewatch@iwla.org about partnering with either Trout Unlimited or any other organizations, we definitely welcome that.
All righty. Thank you, Heather. And then the other one we have open now. First of all, Jill says, great information, Alicia. Not a question, just a comment. And then the other one we have is, do you have any examples of agencies that use your data? So I can answer this one. For our Nitrate Watch program, because it's so brand new, we currently don't have any data use examples, but we're modeling it after our Salt Watch program. So our Salt Watch program is in its fifth full year, sixth calendar year. And in that time, we've really built up kind of a groundswell of volunteers, getting more folks engaged from across the country and in concentrated areas. So we've pursued a couple of grants in Maryland that help us really get on the ground and working with these states and the counties, local cities. And as a result, we are now getting asked by the state as well as our water utility for our data. And we're working with them to follow up because they have some specific impaired watersheds where they're looking for more chloride data. So that's an example that I like to share because this really shows how a groundswell of volunteers in a region can help move the needle as far as volunteer data use and particular issues that we're trying to solve. So while we don't have a specific example of data use for Nitrate Watch yet, I encourage you all to get monitoring, and we're kind of working on the back end with these stakeholders to make sure that that data is accessible and usable and that we're creating change on the ground. Let's see. Have you reached out to Minnesota Pollution Control? Not yet, Jill, not for nitrate. So we're just starting now. We got this off the ground. Now we're going to start building those partnerships. So we're working on that. Great ideas. And if you all are with a partner group that wants to get engaged, shoot Heather an email at nitratewatch@iwla.org. And then last one,
Sam, have we worked with MNPCA on Saltwatch?
Oh yeah, no, we've definitely worked with them on Saltwatch. It's just the nitrate that we haven't gotten there for. So luckily that pathway is already there. And then last question, can we obtain a copy of this presentation and would like to have Alicia's email address? So I think that's pretty findable, but she can type it in the chat. And then all of these webinars are posted pretty much the next day on our website and our YouTube channel. So it'll be on that webinars from the experts tab on iwla.org. And then also if you just search Isaac Walton League on YouTube, it'll come up on there during our webinars section as well. All righty, that's all I got, Heather.
Great. Well, if there's any last minute things you guys are thinking about, feel free to drop those, but I think we can go ahead and wrap it up and say thank you all again for attending. And thank you, especially Alicia, for that really great presentation and obviously for everything you do. And look for that recording and obviously shoot us an email if you've got any questions, but have a great rest of your day, everyone.
Thank you.